from 26 April 2021 to 8 May 2021. This online FDP will be graced by the esteemed presence of Chief Guest Professor K.K. Agarwal, Chairperson NBA, Founder Vice Chancellor GGSIP University New Delhi, Dr. Prakash Chauhan, Director Indian Institute of Remote Sensing Dehradun, Professor R.K. Mittal, Vice Chancellor at Chaudhary Bansi Lal University, Professor S.K. Ghosh, Professor and Head of the Department of Civil Engineering, IIT Roorkee, India, and more than 20 eminent guest speakers of national and international reputation from academics and industry. Faculty development program aims at equipping teachers with skills and knowledge that are essential for inculcating entrepreneurial values in students and guiding and monitoring their progress towards entrepreneurial career. Faculty development program is designed to train and develop professionals in entrepreneurship so that they can act as resource persons in training, teaching, guiding, and motivating young persons to take up entrepreneurship as a career choice. FDPs provide inputs on the process and practice of entrepreneurship development, communication, and interpersonal skills, creativity, problem solving, achievement, motivation, resources available, and all aspects of entrepreneurship. Training methodology includes case studies, group discussion, simulation exercises, field visits, and classroom lectures. This online FDP will be a milestone in the direction of Atmanirbhar Bharat. Through this FDP, university will help our nationwide faculty members to create entrepreneurs rather than a job seeker. Now, to begin with the program, I would like to call our respected director, sir, an ever inspiring and ever motivating principal that one can ever ask for, Professor Dr. R. K. Divedi. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Sonia. It's my proud privilege to welcome all the eminent resource speakers of today's inaugural session. This entrepreneurship training program, in fact, financially sponsored by National Science and Technology Entrepreneurship Development Board, that is NSTEDBD, Department of Science and Technology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India. And this is 15 days. This is 15 days FDP. And first of all, I would like to welcome Professor K.K. Agarwal, who is the chairman of National Board of Accreditation. Our another resource person, Professor R.K. Mittal, sir, who is the Vice Chancellor of Chaudhary Bansi Lal University, Haryana. And Professor S.N. Singh, Professor of Electrical Engineering Department at IIT Kanpur, and former Vice Chancellor of Madan Mohan Malviya Technological University, Gorakhpur. Dr. Prakash Chauhan, who is the Director of Indian Institute of Remote Sensing, Dehradun. Professor S.K. Ghosh, head of the Department Civil Engineering, Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee. Our Honorable Vice Chancellor, who is our guiding source and true motivator, and who usually practice in his research, entrepreneurship is his core area. Area of experimentation, and our Dean, Dr. Manjula. So I would like to welcome you all, and I hope all the participants, after completing this 15 days training program, might be they are able to understand the nuances of entrepreneurial practices, because this is the era of technology wherein all imagination could be transformed with the help of engineering applications and technology, and maybe given a shape which could have a commercial value. So I would like to quote one quotation for entrepreneurial practices that कारीगर हूँ साहब अल्फाजों की मिट्टी से महफिलों को सजाता हूँ कुछ को तो बेकार और कुछ को तो कलाकार नजर आता हूँ. So I hope the addresses of our eminent resource speakers could certainly give a way out to formulate your imagination with the help of engineering applications and technology could be formulated in any kind of device, any kind of business procedures, or that could be anything which could have a commercial value. So with the hope, I welcome all my respected resource speakers, including the speakers of the inaugural session, and I pray to Almighty for a good success of this faculty 2 weeks faculty development program on entrepreneurship. Thank you
sir. Thank you very much for your valuable address and motivation. Now I would like to call our honorable vice chancellor Professor Raghvi Singh to address us on entrepreneurial development. Professor Raghvi Singh is one of the first academic leaders in India where a large multidisciplinary university, TMU, has successfully conceptualized, designed, developed, structured, and implemented the holistic education. The domains cognitive, affective, psychomotor skills have been implemented using OBE and AOL through various educational frameworks and scientific tools, and technique culminated by 2 years massive efforts. He has 25 years of teaching and administrative experience at various university departments and autonomous management institutes as director and HOD in institutes like Manipal University, Jaipur, BITS Pilani, Modi University, Lakshmangarh, BIT Misra, Jaipur, IILM, Jaipur, ISTE, New Delhi, UPES, Gurgaon, JK Business School, Gurgaon. He has hands-on experience in developing quality education ecosystem in higher education institutes. He has conducted numerous MDPs for a number of corporate houses on leadership, interpersonal skills, strategic roadmaps using BSc, using Firo B, Leadership Grid, Thomas Scale, and MBTI, etc. His research areas of interest are turnaround and mergers, human resource and education, and have been conducting FDPs for last 12 years on areas like research methodology, case method teaching, innovative pedagogy, OBE, educational leadership, strategic orientation for educational institutes, etc. Dr. Singh has hands-on experience on developing roadmaps for universities and educational institutes using balanced scorecard. He prefers to focus on 360-degree approach to institutional management. His process and systems-driven approach to strategy execution ensures desired results. Design seamless approach that aligns vision with long-term strategic goals and execution. The KRAs and KPIs are designed to induce and monitor actual performance. Experiment design for university system and large institutions is highly appreciable. He is an expert on accreditation process of NAC and NBA and developing innovative ecosystem. We welcome you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. On the outset, let me congratulate Dr. Rakesh and his team for organizing this two-week FDP on entrepreneurship. I extend my heartiest welcome to our Honorable Professor K.K. Agrawal and Professor R.K. Mittal. It's so nice to have both of you and seeing you early morning. It's made our day. Thank you so much for being here. Wonderful. I've been given to speak about 15 minutes on entrepreneurship. Most of us know that this time, current time, is the best time for any entrepreneur. Simple reason is the risk is low, investment required is low. What is required is your technical skills. And you should have the knack of understanding market needs. It's much different environment than what is to be brick and kiln environment of the past, where you needed huge amount of finances, infrastructure. Thankfully today, you don't need so much. And that's one of the reasons why so much of unicorns have been produced for last 2 years. But the flip side of this is, an estimate says that almost 90% of entrepreneur companies or startups in fact fail, 90% of them. 10% of them fail in first year. 70% of them fail within 2 to 5 years and the remaining over a period of time. One of the biggest reasons stated to be early failure is poor estimate or an assessment of market needs. That is one of the reasons of early failure. Having established and then you fail, that means there is some other reason. It's nothing to do with the risk. Everyone involved in entrepreneurship activities do take risk. As I stated earlier, you don't need big finances. And if you need, there are people, there are agencies, the government to support today. So you will find that not many entrepreneurial organizations have failed because of lack of money. It's more your ability to satisfy the customer needs or wrong identification of customer needs. That means these most important factors which are required to succeed in any entrepreneurial activities do exist, and almost everyone has it common. That means there has to be something else which actually makes a failure. That means there are, other than these, the risk, finance, market needs, there are other factors which are responsible for failure of entrepreneurial activities. You won't find many entrepreneur organizations failing because of technical expertise or because of the lack of funds or because of the risk-taking ability of the entrepreneur, etc., etc. That means there is something else, and that in my mind is softer part of any organization. That is the people in the organization. How do an entrepreneurs handle people and how their own character actually helps them to make an organization successful? And that's the one which in fact today I will like to highlight some of them. Of course, there are a large number of them. So as an entrepreneur, we all know that you got to have a bigger picture, no doubt. You got to have from within, that to do something extraordinary or something different, you got to be the one which it does not get sleep because of your dream, not the one who dreams in the sleep, a different kind of a person. So hence, as an entrepreneur, the young students who are listening to me, I look to advise them, you fix your destination, switch on your headlights, put your legs on the gas and start moving. As you keep moving, you get your path clear. Don't worry about having it, your path charted in advance. No, not necessary. As you move on with your headlights on, you will get your path clearer. Or putting it the other way around, we could learn quite a lot from the fog. In fog, you don't see at a much longer distance. You don't see far in the future. And it's futile to see. So as you keep moving, the path to your destination becomes clearer and clearer. So I would advise you as a young people, the first thing first is you have that technical expertise, you know, that technical skills supposed to be there with you to start your any project today, more than anything else. And of course, that, you know, that will to do something different from others, that has to be there with you. That's your softer part. You know, technical skill, your hard part, and that dream is your softer part, which you need to have. You know, a lot of us have that, you know, tendency to blame things around. Environment is not good, people are not good, government doesn't help, etc. No great person, no achiever has ever blamed anything. They don't blame environment, they don't blame government, they don't blame finance, nothing. They only have a path ahead of them and they keep moving on that particular path. They actually awaken their inner self. That means bring their change the way they think. That is most important for any entrepreneur. So you change your emotions. You know, bring that zeal in you and you find that. Else, if you start blaming people around, you will never ever be able to start up. And people say the biggest reason for failure is inability to take a start. They only plan, they think. That means a lot of thinking, a lot of planning do happen, but never start. And that is one of the reasons we all fail, because we don't start. Believe in yourself. You will find in future life less qualified people than you doing things which you wanted to do and you could not do. Just because of the one reason, because they took a start and you could not take a start. That's the one of the biggest reason why you couldn't achieve what you wanted to achieve, and you see all other people which were much less qualified reaching there where, in fact, you wanted to be. And as an entrepreneur, please be prepared for a massive effort. If you are not prepared for that massive effort, please do not attempt entrepreneurship. Don't attempt for the sake of being an entrepreneur, because you will be doomed to fail if you don't put that massive effort in place. And of course, when you're putting your efforts, please be prepared for adversity. You would bound to fail. None of us has ever succeeded in all our attempts, in all our endeavors. We all have failed. Many of us have failed multiple times. Some have failed once or twice. So be prepared for a failure, but should come back. That should be your spirit. And if you don't do that, then it's better not to start. If you are not prepared for these two important things, that is one, for a massive effort, number two, for adversity. And should have guts to come back from your failure. And my advice to you all, other than, you know, managing your money, managing your technology, managing, you know, anything else or taking a risk, I advise as an entrepreneur three important skills. And these skills will vary depending upon how your entrepreneur venture is shaping up. The first one is most important, technical skill as of now, today's world. Second, people skill. And third is a conceptual skill. In today's environment, the most important thing today you need is your ability to do things. Do you have that technical ability to undertake the customer's need satisfaction or not? If you have that ability, if you do not have, don't attempt it. Have that skill perfected first, and then the people skill, because unless your team works to the perfection, you will never be able to compete at the marketplace. And third one is conceptual skill. As you grow, you will find the need for this conceptual skill is much more higher. Reason being, you should have that ability to relate your product, relate your venture to the environment, you know, to the government policies, the rules, regulations, the market, competitors, etc., etc. And the greater you achieve success, more the need for this conceptual skill. And you'll realize that as you grow, your own technical skills needed would go on reduce because you will be hiring those people to undertake your technical skills. You can't go on serving your customer directly as you grow. So that means when you grow, you got to learn to let go certain things. You know, and unless you let go those particular things, it will be very difficult for you to survive. Now, let me share with you what we should let go. The biggest problem is, you know, entrepreneur is inability to let go many, many things. Because over a period of time, when you started your venture, you have developed that habit of doing everything your own self. Whether it related to technical, related to the market, customer, finance, HR, legal, everything you were doing to begin with. But as you keep growing, the habit also keep growing. So it becomes very difficult for any entrepreneur to let go. So I would advise some of the things which you should let go, and most of that you will realize they are softer part of the people. That is number one, the inferiority, anxiety, the fear, envy, ego, angst, greed, most important, greed, stress, guilt, and above all, worrying over non-controllables. Here, I like to advise my young people to pray every day to the God about, to let you know that what are those things which are controllable and which are those non-controllable? And give you enough power to understand what are controllable, what are not controllable, and also give you ability to distinguish between these two. And then bestow you with that genuine ability to let you not worry about non-controllables and have a control over controllables. If you start worrying, and most of us have that habit of worrying about non-controllables. For example, results are non-controllable, but effort is controllable. Now, as an entrepreneur, I should worry more about my effort, developing my skills, rather than the result, because results are not dependent. If there are 100 factors which are under your control for a given result, there are thousands which are not under your control. So how can a result be under your control? And since result is not you under control, why should you worry about that non-controllable thing? Moment you start practicing these two things, you will have an easy life. You will have enough energy to concentrate on what must be done rather than what must be avoided. And you start putting efforts on that. And I would also advise you to imbibe some of these characteristics in you, which are very, very important. For the first most important characteristic is feel gratitude. Gratitude to everybody, to God, to your parents, to your friends, to your teachers, to this society, to the government, and to the nation. Have a gratitude, feeling of gratitude to everybody. Develop that confidence, irrespective of the environment, irrespective of the situation. Be respectful to the people around, whether you're a subordinate, your colleagues, your seniors, or your customer, whoever it is, be respectful. Have that passion. A lot of people, in fact, confuse themselves with the word passion. You know, for example, if I'm working as a vice chancellor, I say, hey, I have a great passion to undertake my job. No, that's your job. There's nothing passion. Tell me the day if I'm stopped giving paid for this particular job, will I continue to perform the same way? That's called a passion. Your passion will be returns of your effort stop coming to you. And if you feel dejected that day, that means it's not a passion. And never ever lose the self-worth of your answer. That's important. Now, these software, I can go on that way. There is so many things which, in fact, you can discuss on the software parts, which definitely influence the success of any entrepreneur. And above all, I like to advise my young people, please change your mindset to change your outcomes. If you are expecting change in outcomes and continue to do things which you have been doing every day by your habit, you can't have outcomes changed. For changing outcomes, you have to change the actions. And to change your actions, you have to change your self-belief. And the self-belief can only be changed by changing your mindset. Finally, I would like to add or say to my young entrepreneurs that you should remember, as long as you live, you will have two options. The first one, either live on your own dream, live your own dream, or be a resource to someone else's dream. The choice is yours. Make an appropriate choice and have the life youthful, happy, and worth living. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for your inspirational and motivational words. And I'm sure the young generation will be benefited by this. Now, I would like to call Professor K.K. Agarwal, Chairman, MBA, and Founder Vice Chancellor, GGS Indraprastha University. Professor Agarwal obtained his Bachelor's of Engineering degree from Punjab University and Master's degree from NIT Kurukshetra. Later, he did his PhD from NIT Kurukshetra. After a distinguished service of 27 years at NIT Kurukshetra, Professor Agarwal served as Pro Vice Chancellor at JGU Hisar for a period of 3 years, and then as Founder Vice Chancellor of GGS Indraprastha University, Delhi, for a good period of 10 years. He has been a president of the Institute of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineers for the period of 2002 to 2004, president Computer Society of India from 2007 to 2009, and president of Southeast Asia Regional Computer Confederation from 2008 to 2010. Professor Agarwal has published approximately 400 papers in the reputed journals, about 50% of these in international journals. He has been widely consulted by the industry, most notable being his contribution towards the reliability analysis for PSLV. Professor Agarwal was conferred the honorary fellowship by Broadcast Society of India. He was decorated with Lifetime Achievement Award by IETE and also by Computer Society of India. Professor Agarwal has been associated with the NBA in various capacities since its inception and was chairman at EEAC before taking over as chairman NBA on 14th January 2019. We welcome you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the nice introduction. And I'm happy to be at your university as always. Professor R.K. Mittal, my colleague, friend, Vice Chancellor of Chaudhary Bansilal University, Bhiwani. Professor Raghuveer Singh, Vice Chancellor of this university. Shri Akshat Jain, the member of the management of the university, Dr. Prakash Chauhan, Director, Indian Institute of Remote Sensing, Dr. Rakesh Dwivedi, a principal of the Faculty of Engineering and Computer Science, and the general chair for this FDP, and Dr. Garima Goswami, FDP convener for this program. Friends, Whenever Tirthankar Mahavir University has invited me, somehow, I don't know, I feel compelled to join you because of my association with the university right from day one in some sense or the other. And last time I visited you was in the, could make it in physical mode on the insistence of Dr. Dwivedi, who is a great, great persuader. And I did come to the university, although later on I had to pay a heavy price for this. That's a different matter. But this time we're doing it online. And I'm so happy that you are doing a program different than the traditional academic program. You're doing a program on entrepreneurship, and which is sponsored by DST. Which means that even the Department of Science and Technology has taken note of your capabilities of the university on promoting entrepreneurship. Friends, Professor Raghuveer Singh has given quite a detailed guideline for entrepreneurship to the young entrepreneurs, young potential entrepreneurs, I would say. It's his own subject, and therefore the love for the subject was apparent in his address. Friends, any university today will have to focus on entrepreneurship. If you have seen the new policy of education, you will find that entrepreneurship has been stressed quite a bit. And although I am not a formal student of entrepreneurship, but I believe I have experimented with entrepreneurship quite a bit, even in establishing my university in Delhi. See, people sometimes confuse entrepreneurship means are you setting up your own unit or are you setting up your own business? That is entrepreneurship. Friends, yes, that is entrepreneurship. But according to me, that is not the only place where you require your entrepreneurship skills. So I'm not going to talk too much about entrepreneurship as a profession, as a business. I'm going to talk more about entrepreneurship as a skill, which I believe all of us will have to have it. It does not mean all of us need necessarily start our own businesses, but entrepreneurship will still be required. And as I told you, I can count umpteen number of examples, and Professor R.K. Mittal was with me when we were developing IP University in Delhi. I think there were several stages where we were working more like entrepreneurs rather than academicians, because that's the only way you can really make something grow. And I'm sure that way the university is fortunate to have a entrepreneur by knowledge now to run the university. Therefore, entrepreneurship will come in its more strong way in growing this university further. Friends, in the new policy of education, we very clearly say entrepreneurship is a skill. And as I said, today I see a bank manager has to be entrepreneur. He's a salaried person, he's a salaried employee, but he has to be an entrepreneur to grow the business of his bank. A university vice chancellor has to be entrepreneur. It doesn't mean he's setting a factory. Of course, today we say even universities are entrepreneurship, where we have an education entrepreneurship coming in the way. But despite that, if you recognize entrepreneurship as a skill, you will find that you need it, whether you want to start your own business or you want to join someone else or be a part of the team or want to be growing innovatively, the habits of an entrepreneur will serve you well if you acquire them. And I always see entrepreneurship in that light. And therefore, I believe it's a very essential component of all graduates or the products of higher education in the coming days to have entrepreneurship skill in addition to the other skills which we'll talk about briefly. Professor Raghuveer Singh was very right that if you are not prepared to fail, you cannot be an entrepreneur. An entrepreneur, I mean, you don't have to design to fail, but you have to be prepared to fail. Nature designed the world that way. I was reading a paper which gives the title, The Law of Wasted Effort. It says, I'm reading, do you know that lions only succeed in a quarter of their hunting attempts, which means that they fail in 75% of their attempts and succeed in only 25% of them, and we still call them a king of the jungle. Despite the small percentage shared by the most predators, they don't despair in their pursuit and hunting attempts. The main reason for this is not because of hunger, as some might think, but it is the understanding of the law of wasted efforts that have been instinctively built into animals, a law by which nature is governed. Half of the eggs of the fish are eaten. Half of the baby bears die before puberty. Most of the world's rains fall in oceans. And most of the seeds of trees are eaten by birds. Scientists have found that animals, trees, and other forces of nature are more receptive to the law of wasted efforts. Only humans think that the lack of success is in a few attempts is failure. But the truth is that we only fail when we stop trying. Success is not to have a life full of pitfalls and falls, free of pitfalls and falls, but success is to walk over your mistakes and then go beyond every stage where your efforts were wasted, looking forward to the next stage. If there's a word that summarizes this word, it will simply be continue. I think this was the spirit of Professor Raghuveer Singh's, one of the focal points in his, initial remarks. But the point is an entrepreneur which wishes to have a guarantee of success will never be an entrepreneur. You have never, if you read the history of any industrialist or even any good project, people were not afraid of failures. And then only we can try new things, then only we can succeed ultimately. I always quote Thomas Edison when he was trying to find the material for the electric bulb. They failed about 2,000 times. And one day his junior colleague came to him, says, sir, what a waste of effort. We have spent our energy and effort in trying 2,000 materials to make an electric bulb and have failed. Edison smiled. He says, my dear friend, our failure in these efforts is the saving of effort of millions and billions of scientists who will follow us. Now there's a document to tell that these 2000 materials do not make an electric bulb. So they need not waste their time and effort on these 2000 materials and go beyond. So our effort, and that's what the scientist approach and entrepreneurship approach is, that whether my effort leads to my success directly or leads to the success in future is immaterial, although I will always aim at my success. And you know, Edison ultimately did succeed to make an electric bulb and find the material which can use it. In our country, education was always seen subconsciously not working towards entrepreneurship. We were always taught right from the beginning that there's a goddess Lakshmi, which gives you money, and there's goddess Saraswati, which is in charge of knowledge, and the two don't go together. We were made, or I would say, befooled into this paradigm. Therefore, businessmen will never try to acquire knowledge, and our people in the knowledge domains will never try to find sources of money. We were feeling that they are contrary to each other. It's only after the information technology revolution that we realize that the knowledge economy, even the word knowledge economy, synthesizes the two words, knowledge and economy. That is, the money and knowledge can go together. And in lighter vein, I always say that the information technology, which is my subject, is responsible for bringing compromise between the two sisters, Lakshmi and Saraswati. And now they go hand in hand. They go very well together. And you have every right to earn through your knowledge, and you have every right to be more knowledgeable when you are earning money. Now, that is the spirit of entrepreneurship, that we have to be growing in knowledge every day, but at the same time, money is not something bad which must go into our minds as long as our means are pure. Second concept, which we were made to believe all the time, that you are a sage, you are a saint, you are a very knowledgeable person, you are a professor, you are a teacher, therefore don't think about money. We never filed patents in this country by and large, because we believe that patenting is contrary to the spread of knowledge, and which is not good for the people who are who possess this knowledge. So that is why we lag behind patents in this country, because we believe knowledge should not be monetized. Knowledge should be acquired, knowledge should be disseminated, and knowledge should not be exploited to make money. And therefore, in a way, or somewhere down the line, we suppressed entrepreneurship in our youth and in ourselves. And therefore, we never thought of it. Fortunately, now, as I said, this concept is changed. I still remember a small incident in my life. I conducted several courses for TCS on software quality assurance, and I was a retainer consultant to TCS for 25 years. Once I was conducting a course for them in TCS Hyderabad, I think. And I was telling them an algorithm, how can we make a better quality software and all that. A young girl, maybe in her late 20s or something, gets up and she says, "Sir, you know we are a commercial company. We earn from everything. And you are telling us all these algorithms free of cost." I really didn't know the answer to this, because as a teacher, we always believe whatever we know has to be disseminated to as large an audience as possible. But then she herself corrected. She said, "Sir, but then persons like you are supposed to do this." Now, that's the way we had our life, and we never believed that we should change. Now, things are changed, and we believe that the things should go together. Now, if you are conducting a two-week FDP on entrepreneurship, and I have seen the list of resource persons, I'm sure the participants of this program will be very, very highly educated and enlightened on entrepreneurship, looking at the profile of the speakers, which Rakesh and his colleagues have coined for this program. In this initial inaugural session, will just touch a few points. First of all, we have highlighted, both of us, Professor Ravinder Singh and myself, you don't have to be worried of failure. Failure is a part of life. It will happen. I am a software engineering student, and we know We in any software, large software, we make so many mistakes. And many of those mistakes are never detected in life. And we go ahead with that. But if we decide that I will deliver a software after making sure that it does not have a single mistake, probably no software would have been ever delivered worth the size of the software. So we learn to live with a limited amount of bugs still remaining in the software consciously. And as software engineers, we always learn that you have to have a trade-off between the time of release of the software, cost of the software, and reliability of the software. If you want to make a 100% bug-free software, maybe you spend your life on that and never end up with a product. And therefore, an entrepreneur, I believe, will always have to ensure that there could always be situations where failure could arise and he has to move forward. And our COVID, with which we are passing through for last more than a year, is an example how you survive and grow in the face of a failure. None of us knew that we will teach the students from our homes and the students will learn in their at their homes. I belong to engineering discipline, and we always believe, how can engineering be taught at home? But we have done that during the year. Engineers have graduated, they've got jobs, and so on and so forth. So, and I was reading a nice article which says, now in addition to IQ, EQ, SQ, we also have to teach our students what he says is AQ, adversity quotient. We have to make our students prepared for an adversity, because adversities will keep on coming. COVID may not be the last adversity in the lifetime of the civilization. Things will keep on happening on a different scale, of course. Normally, such a large scale is unprecedented. But how to survive in the face of an adversity is an entrepreneurship, and entrepreneurs don't give up. I read a book about 25 years ago or 20 years ago, which says crisis-ready companies make more profits. Now, that's what I want to tell the entrepreneurs. You don't have to wish crisis. You don't have to plan crisis, but you have to be crisis-ready. If crisis comes, I'm prepared to go ahead even then. Now, we have demonstrated in this 1 year plus that our youth is crisis prepared. I think the need is, Corona will go. It had almost gone, but then it made a reappearance. But I hope in a couple of months it will go. But let us wish that our this nature of entrepreneurship, which has been developed during this adversity period, continues with us for creativity and innovation even after this. If I talk about some of these creativity and innovation, online education is one. We never believe, we had never heard of Zoom or WebEx or something like that. These applications were practically non-existent. And they were, or they might be existent in a very minuscule form. But within a month or within a few weeks, they made their presence so felt, and they have made indispensable presence in the world today. Our students have invented ventilators of the size of a toaster in the kitchen for most of the patients with mild symptoms. Our students thought, when we go sea diving, after all, they give us a helmet which is connected to an oxygen pipe. What is that? It's a ventilator in some sense. So they converted that helmet into a ventilator and connected it to an oxygen pipe just by use of a valve. And that valve also was 3D printed in their own lab. So that's the kind of innovation which has been demonstrated in the face of adversity. But adversity should not continue, but that innovation should continue to bring more and more entrepreneurs on the scene. Because as we go along post-corona, I see there will be much more scope for smaller units, multiple smaller units, rather than very few, very large industries. although those may be required in some strategic things, but the labor problem, the migration problem, and the materials movement and all that which we have seen, are probably there will be a stage where we will settle for a sort of compromise solution where we have medium scale units, but larger in numbers. That will also be true of universities. We will have to create, if not the world-class, probably India-class universities in every district at least. We can't ask the students to go to 1,000 kilometers away for education unless there is a special reason for this. And therefore, there will be much more challenging need for entrepreneurship in education also. And if I have touched that subject, because most of you are faculty here and the research students here, so you are exposed to new policy of education. We now say we need the multi-faculty education research universities. We do not need single discipline institutions, and henceforth no more IITs, no more IIMs will be established. We want universities which are multidisciplinary. And I'm addressing this particularly on the portals of TMU because you are a multidisciplinary university already. And by God's grace, you have come up reasonably well in the few decades of your existence as a multidisciplinary university. Please try to make sure that every graduate here has the entrepreneurship skills. Now, how do you develop these entrepreneurship skills? Sometimes entrepreneurship does not require too much of depth of a knowledge. As a matter of fact, as we become more and more specialists, we become more and more comfortable in our own domain of knowledge, and we start becoming afraid of other areas of knowledge, and we start becoming afraid of failure in our own areas of knowledge. And that goes against entrepreneurship at times. Therefore, I read a nice article which says, we need deep generalists. We need people with depth, but we need people with general areas of awareness, general knowledge of education. You can't be an entrepreneur till you have good common sense about business, unless you have good common sense about law, unless you have good common sense about taxation, unless you have good common sense about strategic marketing, unless you have good common sense about supply chain management. So all these things will have to be known to you to some extent if you want to be a successful entrepreneur, which I repeat again, is not only if you want to success, set up your own business, you will need it everywhere. Friends, there was a quote which I read quite some time back, and it's beautifully applicable to entrepreneurship. It says, it is nice to be approximately right than to be accurately wrong. That's the spirit of entrepreneurship. If I'm approximately right, it's fine. I'll improve next time. You do not continue to believe in more and more and more and more accuracy till you have a requirement like that. But an entrepreneur believes in the power of ideas. And Rabindranath Tagore said, power of ideas and power of imagination are inbuilt attributes which an entrepreneur must have. My dear friends, I was reading the biography of Elon Musk, which as of date, I rate as the greatest entrepreneur of the day in the whole world. And I'm taking the liberty of read some lines from that. It says, the first step is to establish that something is possible, and then probability will occur. I think that's what is very necessary. Firstly, you believe that it's possible. If you always have a doubt whether will I succeed, will it happen, then it will never succeed. You have to believe that it is possible and I'll make it happen. And then there is a good probability that it will happen. He has been described in his biography as an innovator, disruptor, game changer. And The author says, what else can I refer to him who founded PayPal, which is a financial application, one of the first financial applications, SpaceX, which sends satellites to the space, Tesla, electric car. Now, all these things do not seem to have any relationship with each other. And that is where an entrepreneur will always have to be thinking beyond a particular discipline, beyond a particular knowledge area, and then only you arrive at solutions. One day he talks about Tesla, other day he talks about a space mission, and so on and so on. He says, school may end, your education in the university will end, but self-education never has to. If your self-education ends, then you have failed. Education one day will have to end, you will get your degree, but self-education has to continue. You don't know what you don't know. Now that's important. I repeat, you don't know what you don't know. And that's the crux of an entrepreneur. Therefore, you always try to keep on reading, keep on studying, keep on browsing so that you do find something which you do not know. And that gives you an appetite to know. Unless you have a knowledge appetite, unless you have a risk appetite, you do not become an entrepreneur. And I was reading again, Elon Musk had read the complete British encyclopedia at a much early age of life. Now that's what the curiosity as a knowledge seeker. As a child, he could read the entire encyclopedia. And he says, best time to be an entrepreneur is when you are young. And that's the signal which I want to give to my young graduating students, young students here, that don't think you can become an entrepreneur at 50. You become an entrepreneur now. And that's the best time to do that because your risk-taking capacity is highest at that age. And you have to be very, very hardworking. And he again says, I quote most of the things from here because he, as I say, is an epitome of an entrepreneurship of the day. He says, if you decide to spend 100 hours a week working, make sure it's not 99. Make sure it is 101. So if you decide you will work 100 hours a week, make sure it's not less than 100. You have to push yourself for that. Otherwise, things will not happen. It also says, if something is important enough, you should try, even if the probable outcome is failure. Failure and success will keep on coming, but you cannot stop trying. And my dear students, my dear friends here, it's a word which is volatile, which is uncertain, which is complex, which is ambiguous, and you must have heard it umpteen time in conferences, which is a VUCA word. And you have, this is a reality of life, you can't wish it away, it will remain VUCA word. Now, how do you succeed in VUCA word? You have to learn to follow the change very fast. You will have to be change leader. You cannot follow the change, you will have to lead the change, you will have to anticipate the change. And number two, you will have to be interdisciplinary by nature, you will have to be multidisciplinary. And number three, you will have to learn from nature quite a lot. What we say is, I read a beautiful paper again, which you can't talk everything in one lecture. It's called biomimicry. He says you learn from plants, you learn from animals, you learn from insects. Don't blame everything on something or the other. I have a smaller unit, therefore I can't do it. The paper gave a beautiful example. He says a small ant can lift two more ants or three more ants on its back, but a big elephant cannot lift another elephant on its back. So it's not always that the big is better. Sometimes the small is better. So what is the optimum size of your entrepreneurial outcome? You have to decide and you have to work on that. And please make sure that sustainability should be ensured for every entrepreneur. And again, I read a beautiful word. It says future belongs to sustainopreneurship. You have to be an entrepreneur making sure that sustainability is built into. If you're an entrepreneur without caring for sustainability, then you will probably contribute to the creation of a not a so good world, which is not very desirable. And because I'm talking from the podium of a university, let me end by saying the last thing is we should encourage students to ask questions. We should not, in our educational system, right from school to higher education, by and large, the spirit of asking questions has gone down, which is not very healthy. I was reading a paper which says a child of four, on the average, asks about 73 questions per day. I mean, it's mind-boggling to many of us, including me, that a child does ask 73 questions per day. These questions may be as foolish as anything. Why should I have to wear clothes? Why should I stand? Why should I not walk? Why am I not able to run? I mean, why should I eat? And so on and so forth. But 73 questions a day, many of them may feel like foolish questions. But that is where he gains the knowledge the fastest. All of us know the learning age is very fast, around 3 to 6. And one of the reasons is at that age, you ask anything from anybody which you like. When you come to school, you are asked to listen to the teacher. Then when you come home, you are asked to listen to the parents. You are never encouraged to ask questions. And I was talking to someone, if a child of four asks 73 questions per day, it's a pity that our education system does not probably allow him or her to ask 73 questions in 15 years. That's the spirit. And I was correlating with an interview which I read of a Nobel laureate. He was Nobel laureate Rabi in physics. He was asked by the media after he got the Nobel Prize in 1942, I think. He says, whom do you give credit for your Nobel Prize? And he said, my mother. They said, is she a physicist? He says, no, she's not even a scientist. She's very little by way of formal education. Then they said, how do you give her the credit for your Nobel Prize? He says, when other children were going to the school, their mothers will invariably ask when they come back from the school, what did you learn at the school? That's a standard thing which many of us do. But my mother always used to ask, did you ask a good question from a good teacher today? And therefore, I was always trying to prepare the previous evening, what good question could I put to a teacher tomorrow? Because I have to answer to my mother. And therefore, I learned to find good questions and seek their answers from my teachers, and that is responsible for giving me the Nobel Prize. So friends, when I am talking to most of the teacher friends here, please let us allow our students to ask us questions. If we don't know the answer, don't worry. We are not supposed to know all the answers. And let the students also understand we are not encyclopedias and knowledge is expanding so fast. But habit of asking questions, then jointly searching the answer, then maybe still failing, that should be the way of life if we want to produce entrepreneurs. Otherwise, we will be producing good salaried employees, which are very happy with the nice packages, but not entrepreneurship and no creativity. And unless we are creative, innovative, and entrepreneurship skills, we will not take the country to where we wish to take it. So with these comments, I'll thank TMU to invite me on this inaugural session of this 2 weeks FDP sponsored by NSTEDB, National Science and Technology Skill Development Board, and wish that you have 2 weeks of very intense knowledge gaining and you become entrepreneur by nature, whether you start your own work or you do any other work. I repeat and wish you all the very best. Thank you once again and all the very best wishes. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for such inspiring words. And I'm quite sure that our young generations will be benefited by this. And very rightly said that we should not get afraid of making mistakes, or we should not sit back after after failing for one or two times. The failures open new doors for us. So now, with these words, now I would like to call our next guest, Professor R.K. Mittal. Professor R.K. Mittal is Vice Chancellor in Chaudhary Bansi Lal University, is a note economist and management educationist, having 30 years of experience in teaching, research, and academic administration in prestigious institutes of higher learning. He has been founder Vice Chancellor of Tirthankar Mahavir University, Moradabad, since 2008 to 2013, Director Development, NAAC, UGC Coordinator, 2014 to 2018, and Dean University, School of Management Studies, 2005 to 2008, at Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi. Additionally, he has been the Dean of School of Education, 2005 to 2007, Dean of School of Humanities and Social Sciences, 2005-2007 at Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi, and HOD in charge of Department of Business Economics, 1996-2000 at Guru Jambeshwar University of Science and Technology, Hisar. In all these institutions, Professor Mittal has the privilege and unique distinction of working from their beginning, thus understanding process of institution building and contribution to their development. Professor Mittal holds PhD, MPhil, MA Economics and BCom from Kurukshetra University and subsequently obtained MBA from Indira Gandhi National Open University, Delhi. Professor Mittal has teaching and research interests in areas of business environment, development issues and policies, competitiveness analysis, banking and financial institutions, managerial economics, leadership and managerial issues in organizations and institutions of higher learning. He has guided 15 PhD theses and about 150 MBA projects with research work of other 6 PhD scholars in progress. His passion for teaching and research is reflected in his publications, 110 in national and international journals and conference proceedings. Talks, he has delivered more than 100 talks and cases written, about 6 cases written, consultancy projects handled, and prestigious workshops, conferences organized by him are more than 50. He's also co-edited 6 books on publication of proceedings of prestigious conferences in management and economics. Professor Mittal is actively associated with academic bodies, associations such as Indian Economic Association, All India Management Association, Global Institute of Flexible Systems Management, NAC, and NBA. He is also in the management board, statutory bodies of various academic institutions. He has been to USA, Japan, and Nepal to present his research papers in various universities. Stephen Institute of Technology, Hoboken, New Jersey, Harvard University, and Massachusetts Institute of Technology in USA. Graduate School of System Design Management, Kyoshi Campus, Kyo University, Japan, and Tribhuvan University, Kathmandu, in Nepal. In recognition of his significant contribution to teaching, research, and corporate life of the university, Professor Mittal has been conferred with the Best Teacher Award in 2002 by Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi. We welcome you, sir. Over to you.
Ji, awaaz aa rahi hai?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Ji. So, dhanyavaad, Dr. Garima Ji. आज के इस कार्यक्रम में हमारे बीच हम सबका मार्ग दर्शन जिनका मिला, आदरणीय प्रोफेसर के अग्रवाल जी, तीर्थांकर महावीर विश्वविद्यालय के कुलपति प्रोफेसर रघुवीर सिंह जी, श्री अक्षत जैन जी, प्रोफेसर एस एन सिंह साहब, प्रोफेसर एस के घोष जी, डॉक्टर प्रकाश चंद्र जी, और इस कार्यक्रम का जिन्होंने आयोजन किया, डॉक्टर आर के द्विवेदी जी, डीन डॉक्टर मंजुला जैन जी और सभी फैकल्टी मेंबर्स और रिसर्च स्कॉलर्स और स्टूडेंट्स, आज हम सबके लिए बहुत ही अत्यंत हर्ष की बात है कि आज इस इम्पोर्टेंट विषय एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप के ऊपर एक दो वीक का जो फैकल्टी डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम है उसकी शुरुआत हुई। मैं जानबूझकर हिंदी में बोल रहा हूं क्योंकि एक दिन राष्ट्रीय शिक्षा नीति के ऊपर माननीय प्रोफेसर के अग्रवाल जी से एक बार बात हुई तो आपने कहा कि क्या राजकुमार आपको सपना कभी हिंदी अंग्रेजी में देखा है, आया है कभी? तो मैंने कहा नहीं सर। तो जो ओरिजिनल आइडियाज हैं वो हिंदी में आते हैं और एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप भी आइडिया से रिलेटेड है, इनोवेशन से रिलेटेड है, क्रिएटिविटी से रिलेटेड है, इसलिए मुझे लगता है कि मैं हिंदी में आज कुछ बोलूं। और ज़्यादातर जो एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप के बारे में एक इंटेलेक्चुअल लेवल पे, प्रैक्टिकल लेवल पे और एजुकेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट को क्या करना चाहिए वो माननीय प्रोफेसर के अग्रवाल जी, जिन्होंने गुरु जम्भेश्वर यूनिवर्सिटी से लेकर गुरु गोविंद सिंह इंद्रप्रस्थ यूनिवर्सिटी और अभी भी NBA जिसके आप अध्यक्ष हैं उसमें नए नए इनोवेशन, नया नवाचार, क्रिएटिविटी आप प्रमोट कर रहे हैं और उससे पूरे देश को लाभ मिल रहा है। जब मैं बात करता हूं एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप की तो मुझे अपने घर के आसपास का, जब मैं गांव में था तो कुछ एनवायरनमेंट वहां पर था उसको समझने का मौका मिला। मेरे ही घर में मेरे जब चाचा जी थे 10वीं पास थे मगर बहुत ही मेहनती थे और कभी फेलियर से घबराए नहीं, कभी दुकान की, कभी खेती की, कभी भैंस की डायरी की दुकान की, फिर चक्की लगाई आटे की और फिर अल्टीमेटली रिटेल की शॉप खोली अंबाला में, कैंट में, और अपना अपना काम नहीं किया बल्कि सारे घर के परिवार के सदस्यों का कम से कम 6-7 वहां पर शॉप उन्होंने खुलवाई। तो मुझे लगता है कि जो मुझे वहां पर एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप देखने की जो उनमें वो मिली वो एक मेरे लिए सबक की बात थी। और जब तीर्थंकर महावीर विश्वविद्यालय में हम एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप की बात करते हैं तो माननीय चांसलर साहब, कुलाधिपति जी श्री सुरेश जैन जी, मुझे 5 साल 1 महीना काम करने का मौका मिला इस विश्वविद्यालय में और कुलाधिपति जी के साथ बहुत बार बातें भी हुई और उनको समझने का भी मौका मिला। ही वॉज फ्रॉम ए रूरल बैकग्राउंड, बहुत मुश्किल से अपना एक एवरेज परिवार से जन्म लिया, उसके बाद खेती का काम किया, डेयरी का काम किया और वुड ट्रेडिंग का काम किया और काम किए, मगर जैसे ही 91 के बाद अपॉर्चुनिटीज आई, जब लिबरलाइजेशन प्रोसेस हुआ, एजुकेशन को भी खोला गया, तब आपने यहाँ पर टिमिट के नाम से एक संस्थान की स्थापना की। और जब मैं यहाँ पर 2008 में आया तो देखा वहाँ पर कुछ ही थे, कुछ ही बच्चे वहाँ पर शिक्षा ग्रहण कर रहे थे, शायद 250-300 होंगे। और बाद में जब 2013 में मैंने यहाँ पर विश्वविद्यालय को छोड़ा तब 13,000 विद्यार्थी यहाँ पर थे और आप लगातार दिन में 1 मिनट आप कभी रेस्ट नहीं करते थे, आइडिया से भरपूर था, हर समय आपके पास किसी ना किसी प्रॉब्लम का सलूशन था। और जो सबसे अच्छी बात मुझे लगती थी, जब भी कोई बात आती थी तब आप कहते थे कि मित्तल साहब ये आप भी पहली बार वाइस चांसलर बने हैं, मैं भी पहली बार चांसलर बना हूं और सब कुछ मिलके कर लेंगे और कुछ ना कुछ इसका सलूशन समाधान निकल जाएगा। ही वॉज ऑलवेज ए ग्रेट लर्नर, मोटिवेटर और उसके कारण आज हम तीर्थंकर महावीर विश्वविद्यालय को एक इतने बड़े विश्वविद्यालय के रूप में देख रहे हैं जिसमें 1,000 बेड का हॉस्पिटल है, कोविड की समस्या जो पूरे देश में है उसमें भी अपना योगदान एक अच्छे तरीके से दे रहा है। तो ये दो इंस्पायरिंग जो मुझे आप अपने आसपास के परिवार में लगे उनको, उनके बेस पर मैं ये कुछ आप लोगों से शेयर किए। साथियों, अर्थशास्त्र में तो एंटरप्रेन्योर के बारे में शुरू से रिकॉग्नाइज, इसको एक फोर्थ फैक्टर ऑफ प्रोडक्शन के रूप में लेते हैं, लैंड, लेबर, कैपिटल, एंटरप्रेन्योर। और एंटरप्रेन्योर वो है जो इनोवेशन करता है। इनोवेशन होता है कि जैसे कहीं से नया रॉ मटेरियल खोजे, नया सोर्स ऑफ फंड्स खोजे, कैपिटल निकाले, डिजाइन को करे और मार्केटिंग करे, इस तरह के जो रिस्क टेकिंग एबिलिटी, ये सारे जो काम करता है उसको हम एंटरप्रेन्योर कहते हैं। आज हम सब जानते हैं कि भारत सोने की चिड़िया कहलाता था। वो क्यों कहलाता था? क्योंकि वहां पर एक प्रॉस्पेरिटी थी, समृद्धि थी, आर्थिक गतिविधियां बहुत ज्यादा थी। और एंगस मेडिसन, एक ओईसीडी ग्रुप ने एक स्टडी कंडक्ट कराई, जिस स्टडी के बेस पर जो ब्रिटिश अर्थशास्त्री थे, हिस्टोरियन थे, उन्होंने भी देखा लगभग जीरो जो ईस्वी से लेके स्टार्ट करके और 1780 तक भी ब्रिटिशर्स जब आए, लगभग उस समय तक भी भारत का लगभग इस पूरे क्षेत्र में, भारत और चाइना दो ऐसे बड़े समृद्ध देश थे जिनका लगभग 25% के करीब जो वर्ल्ड की जीडीपी थी, जो ट्रेड था, वो इन एक एक करके आता था। यानी टोटल 50% और भारत का देखें तो 25% था। लगभग इस पूरे सेंट्रल एशिया में जो स्पाइसेस थे, बांग्लादेश से जो ढाका की मलमल थी और केमिकल्स थे और जो एग्री प्रोडक्ट थे, ये सारों का ट्रेडिंग होता था, उत्पादन होता था और घर घर में एक कहना चाहिए कि फैक्ट्रीज थी जिसमें कि बिजनेस एक्टिविटी होती थी। तो जब बिजनेस एक्टिविटी होगी तो उससे वेल्थ क्रिएट होगी और वेल्थ क्रिएट होगी तो हम कहेंगे कि भाई पूरा राष्ट्र समृद्ध है। अमेरिका भी क्यों आज बड़ा देश मानते हैं? क्योंकि वहां पर वेल्थ बहुत ज्यादा है, वहां का जो जीडीपी का है वो बहुत ज्यादा है। चाइना हमारे बराबर था, आज हमसे बहुत 5 गुना उसकी इकोनॉमी ज्यादा है। क्यों? क्योंकि उसका जीडीपी नंबर बहुत ज्यादा है। हमारा मैन्युफैक्चरिंग में घट कर अब शेयर 3% है, चाइना का लगभग 28% है। पूरे के पूरे वर्ल्ड में वो अमेरिका को और सभी देशों को चैलेंज कर रहा है। क्यों? आर्थिक समृद्धि के कारण, एंटरप्रेन्योरियल स्किल्स के कारण, एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप के कारण। भारत में जब स्वतंत्रता मिली तब हमारे पास एक मौका था, मगर उस समय की परिस्थितियां कहें या उस समय की जो सोच थी वो एक समाजवाद के ऊपर मॉडल के ऊपर आधारित थी और हमने रशिया का मॉडल, जो हम कहते हैं फेल्डमैन मॉडल और महलानोबिस का मॉडल, उसको अडॉप्ट किया, जिसमें ये माना कि जो भारत की समस्याएं हैं उसको पब्लिक सेक्टर के द्वारा, गवर्नमेंट के द्वारा, बड़े बड़े उद्योग लगाकर ये टेम्पल्स ऑफ प्रोडक्शन होंगे, प्रॉस्पेरिटी होंगे, इनके द्वारा होगा। और इसका बड़ा सकारात्मक असर भी हमें देखने को मिलता है। बहुत सारे जितने भी ये स्टील में, एल्यूमिनियम में और जितने IITs, IIMs और इंस्टीट्यूशंस, बहुत लेवल पर इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर भारत में क्रिएट हुआ और उससे सेल्फ रिलायंस को भी मदद मिली। मगर धीरे धीरे चलकर वो जब आगे समय बीतता गया, इंदिरा गांधी जी के समय तक आगे आकर, वो पब्लिक सेक्टर का कंट्रोल बहुत ज्यादा हो गया, मगर उस पब्लिक सेक्टर को हमने कभी मॉडर्नाइज नहीं करा। और एक सम से जो प्राइवेट इनिशिएटिव था जो, उसको बिल्कुल ही बंद कर दिया। और एक सम से जो प्राइम इंपॉर्टेंस इंजन ऑफ ग्रोथ दैट विल बी ड्रिवन बाय द पब्लिक सेक्टर एंड एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप वाज गिवन, द प्राइवेट इनिशिएटिव वाज गिवन ए सेकेंडरी पोजीशन। तो बहुत ज्यादा इसमें एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप ज्यादा नहीं पनपा। कुछ लोगों ने जो गवर्नमेंट के रूल रेगुलेशन, पंचायत जो रेगुलेटरी जो वो कंट्रोल सिस्टम था उसको मैनिपुलेट करके अपना काम शुरू किया। तो इस सब का नतीजा ये हुआ कि हम पिछड़ते चले गए, क्वालिटी के ऊपर ध्यान नहीं दिया, टेक्नोलॉजिकल डेवलपमेंट ज्यादा नहीं हुई और जो मार्केट में प्रोडक्ट बनता था उसको बेच दिया। कोई कंपटीशन नहीं था, ना उनको कोई ज्यादा इंसेंटिव था, ना मोटिवेशन था। और इस सब के कारण हमारी जो इकोनॉमी थी वो एक हाई कॉस्ट इकोनॉमी में चली गई, कट ऑफ होगी। और 90s में हमें बहुत ज्यादा एक ऐसा समय देखना पड़ा जब हमको बहुत सारा अपना इवन गोल्ड को बाहर फ्लेज करना पड़ा और तब IMF और वर्ल्ड बैंक के जरिए से हमें ये जो LPG का मॉडल, हम जिसे कहते हैं लिबरलाइजेशन, प्राइवेटाइजेशन और ग्लोबलाइजेशन, इसको हमने अडॉप्ट किया। और इसके बाद हम देखते हैं कि काफी इसका एक प्राइवेट सेक्टर का जो वो था वो बढ़ा भी। आज हम देखते हैं कि बहुत सारा टेक्नोलॉजिकल भी डेवलपमेंट हुआ, मैनेजीरियल भी डेवलपमेंट हुआ, एफडीआई भी बहुत आई, और जो हमारे यंग एंटरप्रेन्योर थे उन्होंने अपने आप भारत में एक अपॉर्चुनिटीज बिजनेस की ढूंढने लगे। जब पहले उस समय 90s में मैं यदि रिकॉल करूं तो उस समय एक ब्रेन ड्रेन की बहुत इशू सुनते थे, आज ब्रेन ड्रेन की कोई बात नहीं करते हैं। कई बार हम रिवर्स ब्रेन ड्रेन की भी करते हैं कि जो लोग बाहर थे वो सोचते हैं कि अब इंडिया में इतना 130 मिलियन पॉपुलेशन है, उसमें से भी लगभग 90 मिलियन की जो पॉपुलेशन है वो वर्किंग उसमें होगी, तो एक बहुत बड़ा एक मार्केट हम सबके आगे दिखता है। तो इस बेस पर जो एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप अब भारत में जो आगे मुझे लग रहा है कि पनप रही है वो काफी एक फेवरेबल है, इकोनॉमी भी बढ़ रही है, तो अपॉर्चुनिटीज आर इंक्रीजिंग, और बहुत सारे जो गवर्नमेंट के इनिशिएटिव थे उनका, चाहे वो मेक इन इंडिया या स्टार्टअप्स, वेंचर कैपिटल, प्राइवेट इक्विटी और एफडीआई के नॉर्म्स को हमने रिलैक्स किया। अब ये शिक्षा के जितने इंस्टीट्यूट्स हैं उसमें पहले हमने कभी इनके बारे में, एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप के बारे इतना ज़्यादा जब हम पढ़ते थे नहीं बात बहुत ज़्यादा होती थी, आज कम से कम इसके बारे में बहुत सारी चर्चाएं एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप के बारे में होने लगी है, जो एक बहुत अच्छी बात है। तो एक तो ये, और एक बहुत अच्छी जो सुखद बात मुझे जो लगती है वो ये है कि पहले एंटरप्रेन्योर जो थे एक पर्टिकुलर सिस्टम से, कास्ट से या एक कम्युनिटी से, कहें कि जो बिजनेस कम्युनिटी है, वैश कम्युनिटी है, या इन लोगों के साथ जुड़ा हुआ था। आज जो एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप है वो इरिस्पेक्टिव ऑफ कास्ट, जो यंग बच्चे हैं वो किसी उसके भी हों वो आगे आ रहे हैं। मुझे अभी एक स्टोरी पढ़ने का मौका मिला, मिस कल्पना सरोज, आप एक स्टूड कास्ट फैमिली से हैं, दलित फैमिली से बिलोंग करती है, 12 साल की उम्र में आपकी शादी हुई, उसके बाद इन लॉज में आपको हरेसमेंट, इनजस्टिस, फेल्ड मैरिज, और उस सारे से बचने के लिए आप अपने चाचा जी के घर मुंबई आई, और मुंबई में आपने गारमेंट इंडस्ट्री में कुछ नौकरी किया जिससे कि आप फैमिली को सपोर्ट करने का काम किया। उसके बाद धीरे धीरे आपने अपना एक टेलरिंग का बिजनेस शुरू किया, फर्नीचर का स्टोर खोला, रियल एस्टेट का करा, और धीरे धीरे आप ट्रेड यूनियंस और इन एक्टिविटी में आपने हिस्सा लिया, और एक कामनी ट्यूब्स के नाम से एक कंपनी है जो लगभग लिक्विडेशन हो रही थी, तब कुछ लोगों ने मिलके, एम्प्लॉयज ने वहां से मिलके उसको एक अपने हिसाब से खरीदा, और आज आप उसके एक सक्सेसफुल सीईओ को, चीफ एग्जीक्यूटिव ऑफिसर हो। तो एक बहुत बड़ी सक्सेस स्टोरी है जो एक दलित परिवार से होकर आप निकली है, और आप रिसेंटली भी आप बहुत सारे एग्जाम्पल हमें देखने को मिलते हैं दिल्ली में, जैसे बिट्टू टिक्की वाला, हम कहते हैं बीटीडब्ल्यू आपके उत्तर प्रदेश से है और दिल्ली में आया और धीरे धीरे बिजनेस अपॉर्चुनिटी को सेंस किया, और छोटे से एक ब्रांडेड 3,000 करोड़ की एक कंपनी है जो हजारों लोगों को, कितने लोगों को आज बिजनेस दे रही है। इसी तरीके से शिव नरेश है, वो उन्होंने कितना एक इंटरनेशनल लेवल पे ब्रांडेड जो स्पोर्ट्स के एरिया में गारमेंट्स में है, जो बड़ा रेपुटेड है। हमारे पतंजलि के बाबा रामदेव जी हैं, उन्होंने आप देखो उन्होंने कुछ एरिया में अपने योग में, आयुर्वेदा में अपना स्किल को पहले हिमालय में जाकर और साधना से उसको ज्ञान को अर्जित किया, और उस ज्ञान को फिर अल्टीमेटली कमर्शियल वैल्यू में उसको इंक्लूड किया, इनकॉर्पोरेट किया, और आज कितनी वैल्यू जनरेटिंग वो कंपनी है, 2,000 करोड़ की कंपनी है, बड़ी से बड़ी MNC भी उसके साथ के साथ वो टक्कर लेती है, रादर वो घबराए हुए हैं और उनको अपनी प्रोडक्ट रेंज को, अपने भारत के प्रोडक्ट रेंज के साथ, वैल्यूज के साथ उनको मैच करना पड़ रहा है। तो ये एक ऐसे और अनगिनत सक्सेस स्टोरीज हैं जो आज मैं कहूं कि लोगों में, बच्चों में आज एक थोड़ा विश्वास बना है, और इसको आगे जो गवर्नमेंट की पॉलिसीज है मुझे लगता है उससे और बढ़ेगा। यदि हमें भारत की जो आज समस्याएं हैं उनको यदि समाधान करना है, मुख्य रूप से जो समस्या है वो है एम्प्लॉयमेंट की, जब ग्रोथ पहले 91 के बाद लगभग 8-9 एवरेज 8% के करीब ग्रोथ रहा, तब भी हम जॉबलेस ग्रोथ की बात करते थे। अब कोरोना में और कोरोना से पहले भी स्लो डाउन था, तब भी जॉबलेस ग्रोथ की बात करते हैं। तो यहाँ पर जो एक सिचुएशन है वो किस तरीके से लोगों का जो ट्रेंड है, जो लोगों की हम विश्वविद्यालयों में भी देखते हैं, जो मानसिकता है वो है कि सरकारी नौकरी मिल जाए। और आप सरकारी नौकरियों का डाटा आप देखोगे तो लगभग सारे स्टेट और सेंटर को लगा लें 2.5 करोड़ के करीब जॉब्स हैं, उसमें से जो एनुअल रिक्रूटमेंट होता है वो लगभग 1 लाख के करीब होता होगा मैक्सिमम। अब 1 लाख लोगों को हम जॉब सरकार में दे सकते हैं, जो रिक्वायरमेंट है कम से कम मैं बता रहा हूँ 1-1.5 करोड़ की है जॉब्स की। तो वो 1-1.5 करोड़ इस गवर्नमेंट से तो कभी भी आएगा नहीं, दैट इज फार ग्रांटेड, चाहे कितनी इस पे कोई पॉलिटिक्स कर ले, चाहे कितना इस पे रिजर्वेशन कर ले या कुछ भी कर ले, इससे होने वाला नहीं है। यदि होगा तो वो तभी होगा जब लोग अपने धंधों में लगेंगे और जो यूथ है उनका माइंडसेट चेंज होगा और वो आगे इस बिजनेस एंटरप्रेन्योरियल एक्टिविटी में, बिजनेस की एक्टिविटी में आएंगे और ये जॉब प्रोवाइडर बनेंगे, ना कि जॉब सीकर रहेंगे। इस तरह का यदि उनका माइंडसेट चेंज होगा तो मुझे लगता है इस समस्या का हम हल निकाल पाएंगे। जो हम सभी शिक्षा के जगत में जितने भी लोग लगे हैं तो उन सबके ऊपर भी एक बहुत बड़ी एक ये रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी आ जाती है कि हम केवल डिग्री के लिए ना दें। डिग्री तो जॉब के लिए ठीक है, गवर्नमेंट की जॉब्स में चलता है, मगर मार्केट में उसकी है कि नहीं, मार्केट के लायक उसकी स्किल है कि नहीं, इस चीज को इंश्योर करना ये हमारा एक हमारे लिए एक बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज है। जो पिछले 2-3 बातें जो मुझे इस अपने चौधरी बंसीलाल विश्वविद्यालय में भी और जब मैं तीर्थंकर महावीर विश्वविद्यालय में था तब भी हमने एक कुछ लिमिटेड स्केल पे किया था। तीर्थंकर महावीर विश्वविद्यालय में जब हम थे हमने इंडस्ट्री के साथ एक कनेक्ट करने का एक अभियान चलाया था, उसके अंतर्गत गजरोला में जो बिजनेस एसोसिएशन है, मुझे याद है उस टाइम श्री चेतन चौहान जी उसके चेयरमैन थे, वहां पर उनके साथ मिलकर हमने एक मीटिंग की थी जिसमें 50-60 लोग आए थे। उसके बाद सैलाकुई उधर देहरादून के आसपास कहीं जगह है जहाँ फार्मास्यूटिकल सेक्टर बहुत डेवलप है, वहां पर हमने किया था। और इसी तरीके से इस रोड पर जिधर हम नैनीताल में जाते हैं वहां पर हमने एक सेमिनार किया था और नोएडा में सेमिनार किया था। उसका पर्पज यही था कि किस तरीके से हम इंडस्ट्री के साथ अपनी एक्टिविटी को जोड़ें ताकि वो लोग हमें समझें, हम उनके हिसाब से काम करें। तो एक प्रैक्टिकल एजुकेशन, जो एक राष्ट्रीय शिक्षा नीति भी जो 2020 इसकी बात करती है, उसको भी हम सही तरीके से इम्प्लीमेंट कर सकें। और मुरादाबाद मुझे लगता है कि एक ऐसा एरिया है जो स्मॉल स्केल सेक्टर के लिए, हैंडीक्राफ्ट के लिए उसके लिए जाना जाता है। यहाँ पर इस पूरे एरिया में केमिकल्स की भी बहुत छोटी छोटी इंडस्ट्री है और हम सब के लिए एक अच्छी बात है कि आज वाइपो वर्ल्ड इंटेलेक्चुअल प्रॉपर्टी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन का 26 अप्रैल जो है वो एक आईपी इंटेलेक्चुअल प्रॉपर्टी डे के रूप में मनाया जाता है। तो किस तरीके से हम इस स्मॉल स्केल सेक्टर की, जो सर ने भी बात कही प्रोफेसर अग्रवाल जी ने, कि वहां पर पेटेंटिंग और इस तरह की जो नॉलेज है उसमें इस कंपिटिटिव वर्ल्ड में हम ये कहें कि भाई ये ज्ञान है इसको बांट देंगे और बांटने में फायदा होगा, वसुदेव कुटुंबकम, ये सब अच्छी बातें हैं, मगर इसके साथ साथ ये भी जरूरी है कि हम इतनी बड़ी इन्वेस्टमेंट करते हैं, इस बड़ी बड़ी इन्वेस्टमेंट को प्रोटेक्ट करना और उनके ब्रांड्स को प्रोटेक्ट करना, ब्रांड्स को क्रिएट करना, ये बहुत अत्यंत जरूरी है। तीर्थंकर महावीर विश्वविद्यालय में ये पूरा का पूरा यहाँ पर जो पूरी फैकल्टी है वो राइट कंडीशन में है, क्योंकि आपका इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट, जैसे हमने यहाँ पर भिवानी में एक कुछ स्टेप्स लिया, उस स्टेप्स के अंतर्गत हमने यहाँ के लोकल इंडस्ट्री के साथ एक डायलॉग किया, तो उसमें से जो मुख्य बात निकल कर आई कि जी हम छोटा छोटा उद्योग है, हम डिजिटल मार्केटिंग नहीं कर सकते। तो मुझे लगता है आपका इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट यहाँ पर डिजिटल मार्केटिंग, डिजाइन, प्रोडक्टिविटी इन्हांसमेंट और जो इस कोरोना में या अदरवाइज जो अफेक्ट हुए हैं उनको किस तरीके तरीके से मदद कर सकता है, ये बहुत आवश्यक है। और बहुत लंबा विषय है, ज्यादा ना बोलते हुए एक लास्ट में मैं ये कहूंगा, जो विश्वविद्यालय जो हमारे अप्रोच अब होनी चाहिए, और शायद ये इसमें राष्ट्रीय शिक्षा नीति भी जिसकी बात करती है, कि किस तरीके से हमारी हमारे बच्चों की हमारी फैकल्टी की जो अंडरस्टैंडिंग है लोकल कम्युनिटी के बारे में, लोकल एरिया के बारे में, इसके बारे में यदि हम अपनी एक्टिविटी को रीओरियंट करें, उसको समझें और बच्चों को उस दिशा में लगाएं, जितने हमारे प्रोजेक्ट हैं वो उनका एक सोल्यूशन निकाल के लाएं। दे शुड नॉट कम आउट एवरी टाइम विद प्रॉब्लम, बट रादर दे शुड कम आउट विद सोल्यूशन, व्हाट कुड बी द पॉसिबल सोल्यूशन। अब वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट कितना एक बहुत बड़ा एरिया है, सैनिटेशन का एक बहुत बड़ा एरिया है, वाटर क्लीन वाटर वाटर ट्रीटमेंट एक बहुत बड़ा एरिया है, सस्टेनेबिलिटी सर ने बताई वो एक बहुत बड़ा एरिया है, यहाँ पर जो सॉयल की क्वालिटी है सब जगह वो डिटोरिएट हो रही है, उसकी टॉक्सिटी बढ़ रही है, उस सॉयल की क्वालिटी को कैसे इम्प्रूव करें, जगह जगह पर जो हमारा स्मॉल स्केल सेक्टर है वो डिजाइन में पीछे जा रहा है, वो आईटी में पीछे जा रहा है, और उनको जो उनका जो इनोवेशन कैपेसिटी है वो कम हो रही है, उसको कैसे इम्प्रूव करें। और एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर स्पेसिफिकली मैं बताना चाहूंगा कि एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर में 50 करोड़ के करीब, सॉरी 50% के करीब अभी जो वर्किंग पॉपुलेशन है, यानी 25-26 करोड़ के करीब इसमें एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर में अभी भी जॉब्स में लोग लगे हुए हैं, और बहुत हाईली डिस्ट्रेस में ये सेक्टर है, इसको डाइवर्सिफाई करना बहुत जरूरी है। आम होता है सॉरी उसका जैम बनाना, वैल्यू एडिशन प्रोडक्ट उसमें जनरेट करना, उसमें जो फॉरेस्ट्री है उसको करना, जो एनिमल लाइफ है उसको करना, जो तालाब है उनको रीजेनरेट करना। तो टोटल जो ओवरऑल, मैं जब अपने समय को रिकॉल करता हूँ, 91 तक मैं अपने गांव से मेरी पढ़ाई हुई, और उसके बाद से मैं आज देखता हूँ तो वहां पर पानी सॉयल ये सारी की सारी ये कमजोर हुए। तो इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर इन दैट वे इन टर्म्स ऑफ नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज हैज बिकम मोर फ्रेजाइल। तो व्हाट कुड बी द पॉसिबल सॉल्यूशन फॉर ऑल दीज थिंग्स। आई थिंक इवन जो रूरल और अर्बन एरिया का जो यूथ है, हमें उसमें जो प्रॉस्पेरिटी, जो सी के प्रहलाद जी कहते थे प्रॉस्पेरिटी लाइज एट द बॉटम ऑफ द पिरामिड, दैट लाइज इन द रूरल एरिया ऑल्सो। तो वहां पर हम टेक्नोलॉजी, और दो चीजें मुझे समझ कर आती हैं जो यहाँ पर हम प्रैक्टिकल 2-3 हमने काम जो इनिशिएटिव लिया, एक इनिशिएटिव ये लिया कि हम CBLU ई मार्ट बना रहे हैं, जो लोगों को जो इस एरिया के दादरी और भिवानी के जो लोकल प्रोडक्ट हैं, स्वदेशी प्रोडक्ट हैं, इनके लिए सेलिंग का एक प्लेटफॉर्म प्रोवाइड करेंगे। दूसरा एक ऑनलाइन वेब से होगा कि जो इस लोकल इंडस्ट्री हमारी यहाँ है उनको किस टाइप की स्किल चाहिए, और दूसरा हमारे बच्चों में क्या स्किल है उसकी स्किल मैपिंग का एक काम हम कर रहे हैं, और तीसरा बीच में भी बात आई थी कि हाउ टू मेक इंडिया आत्मनिर्भर। जब हम आत्मनिर्भरता की बात करते हैं तो आत्मनिर्भरता यूपी को भी बनाना पड़ेगा, हरियाणा को भी बनाना पड़ेगा, और नीचे लेवल तक मुरादाबाद को भी बनाना पड़ेगा। एवरी वन हैज टू कंट्रीब्यूट इन मेकिंग इंडिया आत्मनिर्भर, और उसके लिए हम लोकल लेवल पर जो अपनी स्टडीज कर सकते हैं उसकी अंडरस्टैंडिंग को बढ़ा सकते हैं। यदि ऐसा हम करेंगे तो बच्चों को अपने आप उसमें एक एंटरप्रेन्योरियल एक्टिविटी, इकोनॉमिक एक्टिविटीज नजर आएंगी। एक समय था जब हम, सर ने भी जैसे बताया कि धन कमाते थे, पैसा कमाएंगे तो उसको एक कंटेम्प्ट की तरफ से देखा जाता था, उसको गलत नजर से देखा जाता था। जो भी अर्थव्यवस्थाएं अपने एंटरप्रेन्योर को निग्लेक्ट करती हैं वो पिछड़ जाती हैं, और ये हमारा जो चाणक्य की नीति है वो भी यही बताती है कि वेल्थ इज क्रिएटेड थ्रू इकोनॉमिक एक्टिविटी, यदि रिवर्स होगा तो डिस्ट्रक्शन होगा और कोई भी स्टेट स्ट्रांग नहीं होगा। तो इसलिए स्टेट को स्ट्रांग करने के लिए, एम्प्लॉयमेंट को जनरेट करने के लिए हमें इस एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप को बढ़ाना है। इसके लिए जरूरी है कि जो हमारे बच्चे हैं उनमें कॉन्फिडेंस जनरेट किया जाए, एक स्वावलंबन की एक फीलिंग डेवलप किया जाए, दे कैन डू, दे हैव द कैपेसिटी, दैट कैपेसिटी वी हैव टू बिल्ड इन थ्रू आवर एजुकेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट। आई एम वेरी श्योर कि जितने भी हमारे साथी जो आज इस 2 वीक का फैकल्टी डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम अटेंड करेंगे, इस फैकल्टी डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम के तहत उनका जो एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप को प्रमोट करने का जो एक तरीका है, उसके जो टिप्स क्यूज प्रोफेसर अग्रवाल जी ने भी और प्रोफेसर रघुवीर सिंह जी ने भी आप सबको दिए, और आगे भी जितने भी एक्सपर्ट हैं वो सब आपको इस बारे में चर्चा करेंगे। तो मुझे पूरी उम्मीद है कि आप लोग तीर्थंकर महावीर यूनिवर्सिटी को ऐसा लोग जानेंगे कि इसने मुरादाबाद के हैंडलूम सेक्टर का नक्शा बदल दिया, और ये इस पूरे के पूरे एरिया में, चाहे वो वीमेन एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप हो या कोई और हो, उसको आगे बढ़कर ले रही है। यही आत्मनिर्भर भारत की तरफ एक सही कदम होगा। मुझे इस कार्यक्रम में आज बोलने का मौका मिला, आने का मौका मिला, तो इसलिए मैं आप सबका धन्यवाद देता हूँ। जय भारत।
थैंक यू सो मच फॉर योर वैल्यूएबल एंड एनकरेजिंग वर्ड्स। नाउ वी हैव डॉक्टर प्रकाश चौहान विद अस। डॉक्टर प्रकाश चौहान, डायरेक्टर, इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ रिमोट सेंसिंग, देहरादून। Dr. Prakash Chauhan has obtained his postgraduate degree in applied geophysics from Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee, and PhD in physics from Gujarat University, Ahmedabad. Prior to joining Indian Institute of Remote Sensing, Dehradun, he was the group director at the Space Application Center, ISRO, and Ahmedabad since 2014. He joined Indian Space Research Organization in 1991 as scientist, and since then working for the application of remote sensing technology for natural resources management for ocean and land resources. Initiated research activities for planetary remote sensing at Space Application Center to study solar system objects, mainly Earth, Moon, and Mars, through Indian planetary missions. His major achievements are in the area of Earth observation applications, including development of algorithms for ocean color parameter retrieval, marine living resources assessment, aerosol remote sensing for space-based air quality monitoring, river and reservoir, water level estimation using space-borne altimeters, and coastal zone management. He has done lead work in using hyperspectral data for lunar surface composition mapping using HYSI and Moon Mineralogical Mapper. Instruments of Chandrayaan 1. He has been the principal investigator for infrared imaging spectrometer instrument on board Chandrayaan 2 mission. He has also led a team scientist for scientific analysis of data from Mars orbiter mission instruments. He has published more than 100 research papers in both national and international journals. He is executive member of International Ocean Color Coordinator Group and representing ISRO. He has also represented ISRO at CEOS as co-chair for Ocean Color Virtual Constellation. Currently, he is a member of prestigious NASA ISRO Planetary Science Working Group. He has been awarded prestigious Professor P.R. Pisharotri Memorial Award for the year 2004 by Indian Society of Remote Sensing. Hari Om Ashram Prerit Dr. Vikram Sarabhai Research Award by Physical Research Laboratory, Ahmedabad for 2009. ISRO Merit Award by Indian Space Research Organization in 2010, and Satish Dhawan Award by ISRS Dehradun for 2016. So we are really honored to have you over here with us. Over to you, sir, and our heartiest welcome to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, madam. Thank you very much. Most respected Vice Chancellor of Tirthankar Mahavir University, Professor Raghuveer Singh Ji, Professor K.K. Agarwal Ji, Professor Mittal Saab, all other dignitaries, those who are present for this today's program, and Professor Rakesh Dwivedi Ji, first of all, I would like to extend my greetings and warm welcome from my side to each one of you at Tirthankar Mahavir University. And I am especially grateful to Professor Rakesh Dwivedi Ji that he has invited me to attend this inaugural function of 2 weeks faculty development program on entrepreneurship skills. First of all, I would like to say that I always cherish my association with Tirthankar Mahavir University. I have been there previously also because of my association with the city of Muradabad. I belong to that city. I have been I have been born in the city. I have got my education, and I my parents also live. So, in fact, I was keen to come physically, but because of the current situation of the pandemic, I could not come. However, as has been told by the morning speakers, Tirthankar Mahavir University is doing wonderful job in this part of the country in terms of promoting high quality education, as well as, developing large amount of multidisciplinary activities across different disciplines. And I congratulate the university management, Professor Raghuveer Singh ji, as well as Professor Rakesh Dwivedi ji and his entire faculty members for doing this commendable job in this part of our country. So as we have been hearing since morning, the topic for this faculty development program is on the entrepreneurship skill, and the objective is that we have to also train our teachers, with the skills and knowledge which are required to generate entrepreneurs from the university setup, which is a very important task. And my previous speakers, Professor Agarwal and Professor Mittal and Professor Singh, in the morning, they have touched various aspects of developing entrepreneurship. As has been told in the morning, entrepreneurship is not only just to start business. It can be there in different fields. We all need to be entrepreneurs today in our own respective disciplines. Even though I am a salaried person, but if I don't perform, I may not remain in my position. That kind of mantra is there now in a very so-called secure job. Even in government jobs now, in ISRO, we follow a philosophy called performance related incentive schemes. So if you do better performance in your respective assigned field, you are likely to get more financial benefits. So to achieve those objectives, one has to go out of the box. You have to think in different directions and start working towards achieving the respective goals which you set up. Now, since I come from space fraternity of the country, and Indian Space Research Organization has done commendable job in last more than 50 years in developing the space program of this country from scratch. You must have seen the photographs where initially our forefathers or the founders of ISRO were carrying parts of rockets and satellites on bullock cart. And today we are the, you can always say that we are the fifth largest space agency of the world. And we have joint collaborative programs with space agencies like NASA, with European Space Agency, with Japanese Space Agency, and many other, leading space agencies of the world. And large amount of, global players are today gearing up to work with ISRO in various aspects of space, as well as, providing space-based services for the development of the community. Now, what is most important to develop entrepreneurship skills, has already many of the aspects have been touched upon, the value system, the technological aspects. I would like to emphasize here on the opportunities. If you want to be a very successful entrepreneur, of course, as has been told, many startups or many businesses which starts, they really don't sustain. But if you want to be a little smarter guy, you need to know where are the opportunities. And if you go to the paths which are less traveled, and technology today, because most of you are coming from this departments of computer science and computational engineering, many of you will agree that we have to identify those niche areas which are new, where many the competition is less, and the new paths are being created. So that is the most important aspect. So we need to identify, we need to teach our students, we need to tell our students which are the new areas and emerging areas where we can see a good amount of sustainable growth in next, 1 or 2 decades. Because entrepreneurship is not only for 1 year or 2 years. If you are venturing into an area, you also have to see that how you can sustain your business for a long period of time so that you can really become a big business house in future to come. So that opportunity or identifying those opportunity is very, very important. You see, today we are going through this pandemic situation and large amount of newer products are coming into the market. And many people are trying to capture this particular time also in terms of developing new opportunities, new startups, and many new such things have come up in a very short period of time in India. See, this I show you one product, a lot of people are not aware about it. This is just a smart card people are developing. It is basically, it's called virus shutout. So a small chemical they are putting in this pouch and they are distributing, and they say that probably it can keep you away from different kind of pathogens which are there in the air. We don't know how effective it is, but you see in market, people are demanding such products so that they can remain safe as far as this time is concerned. So in the field of space technology, as well as in geospatial world, government of India has also made large changes in the policy towards developing entrepreneurship skills. Last year, you must have seen many announcements were made where, we are seeking to liberalize, the participation of private sector in the space technology in this country. And ISRO has now really promoted in last 1 year, many of these programs. And we are now seeking proposals from youngsters and many young startups to develop or to contribute to the space program of India. Now, many of you may be aware that space program basically is highly technological, technologically driven, and you have to be very, very accurate. The chances of error are very minimal. If you have to be, accurate up to 99.999%, even 0.001% error in such kind of high technology or the last frontier areas is going to be, very, very decisive in terms of success and failures. So many new startup companies are getting developed in India, and ISRO is supporting them in terms of, providing access to ISRO facilities. These facilities are basically meant for developing rockets, for developing spacecrafts, for developing sensors in terms of hardware. So we have what we call the upstream activity. That means you have to develop the space infrastructure. So for that, you need, if you want to send a small satellite or a nano satellite, you need to develop a satellite bus. You need to develop sensors which can collect data about various aspects like satellite communication, satellite navigation, space-based imaging services, weather services, as well as what we call as the location-based services. So that is the area which is developing very fast, and many new, young tech students are contributing in this aspect. Now, if you are a young startup, you cannot create, because if you have to qualify these systems for space, for space transportation, you need large amount of facilities for qualification purpose. So what government has told ISRO, and ISRO is working very actively, that we are opening up our facilities to the entrepreneurs if they are interested in these niche areas. And they can come and work with ISRO and do the testing of their, products in our laboratories, where large amount of capital investment has been done in last 50 years, so that you need not bring so much of capital, because it's a very capital intensive industry. So these kind of handholding already government of India has provided enough policy directives, and another institution called In Space has been created by Department of Space to help the young entrepreneurs developing the space tech in this country. Then apart from the space segment or the upstream segment, we have the downstream segment also. Basically, where a lot of people are working in developing services based on the space-based products. Now, in this field, so satellite communication, large amount of companies, even Airtel is coming, is coming up with a new, venture where they are going to have their own satellite systems, very small nano satellite system, which will provide you high throughput communication in terms of internet connectivity. Because today, internet has become like oxygen or water. If you are not having internet connectivity, even for a few minutes in your homes or in your offices, you feel that you are missing a great deal, or it is like, you know, essential service for doing businesses, for conducting your life itself. Today's interaction which we are doing is a classical example of that. So the world is moving now towards the space-based internet connectivity, where the satellite systems can provide you, even in the remotest part, high throughput satellite internet connectivity. And many of the private companies in India are now going to own up their own satellite systems for providing communication services to the masses in large. So you will see next 4 or 5 years, this particular niche area is going to get developed. So many of you can think of, you know, providing ancillary services to the big players in the field of, you know, communication services. If you are an electronics engineer, if you are a computer engineer, or if you are a person who is good in IT also, will have large amount of opportunity in this area. The second service sector, which is developing very fast, is the location-based services. You know, today, if you want to order pizzas, if you want to do order, you know, your groceries, all of you are using these e-commerce platforms, and especially it is becoming very important in today's time, where you know, large amount of conglomerates are getting shut. There are difficulties in terms of opening markets. Big malls are not working. So sitting at your home itself, you are able to access many of these markets through the e-commerce systems. Now, all these e-commerce systems, the backbone is the satellite navigation. Many of you may not be aware, but the GPS system or the navigation system, which is developed by ISRO in India, it's called IRNSS or NAVIC system, which is our own version of GPS. Today, without that, you cannot, you know, send material from one place to another place, because the location is the most important aspect. So these location-based services, many of the young entrepreneurs are using them in a very, very, you know, innovative way to send products from one place to another product. Geographic information system, GIS, which is another software system which integrates large amount of spatial and non-spatial data, is today is being used for effectively, you know, transporting many goods, even, you know, transporting agriculture produce, transporting food items, transportation of milk through optimal routes, you know, where you can reduce the timing of supply as well as reduce, cut the cost of transportation, is now a very, very popular tool. And in IIRS Dehradun, today in the afternoon, we are inaugurating a course for our management professionals, where they are using geographical information systems technology for what we call as the supply chain management. So if you are a manager who is dealing with the supply chain management of different aspects, whether in the field of agriculture, in the field of dairy products, in the field of, you know, any other goods transportation, you know, you would like to know what are the optimal ways in which you can manage your supply chain and how best you can cut down on the costs by using these technological interventions. So some of these areas are going to be most big opportunities in times to come, because as we, many of the previous speakers talked about opportunities which were created in India, where the Lakshmi and Saraswati, they both converged together with IT revolution. You know, this geospatial will be a new revolution in India, because without location today, nothing is possible. If I want to deliver certain thing, first question will be there, where to deliver. So the location is most important. If you want to monitor the infrastructure projects, government is very keen. They're spending large amount of money in e-governance practices and bringing transparency in the governance. If a road being constructed and a person wants to monitor, or even a senior executive wants to monitor whether the road is being built or not, let's say in Mizoram or in a very remote part of the country, today they need not visit that area. Using their own office infrastructure and high resolution satellite images, which are, you know, available on a daily basis, who can monitor the progress of the projects which are being taken up by public funding or by private funding. So these are some of the new areas where large amount of service industry is required, which can develop such kind of tools, either Android-based or maybe at you know, dashboard-based solutions for the decision makers. So this service industry today is roughly around $7 to $5 billion US dollars for Indian as well as around Indian, you know, subcontinent. We need not worry about India itself. You know, large amount of entrepreneurship skills will be required for Africa. for developing countries in our neighborhood, like, you know, the BIMSTEC countries, countries in the Eastern Corridor. So these are the players where you can think of looking in terms of developing the services which are basically being provided by satellite-based data sets. So this market is likely to grow by $20 billion US dollars with a CAGR of around 15 to 17% on an annual basis. So by 2025, so there is huge opportunity waiting for young entrepreneurs in this particular area. And it is up to the teachers. You know, the teachers need to teach and tell the students where they should go. You know, everybody is having, most of the people will have a hammer, but the successful technician will be the one who knows where to hit from that hammer so that the yield becomes maximum. So that is where I think that we need to apprise our students to, you know, look for the newer opportunities. Another niche area which is getting developed in terms of the cloud-based infrastructure today is the world of big data analytics, and large amount of data is getting generated. And as in the morning, Professor Agarwal told, it's a knowledge-based economy and data provides you knowledge. So today, if you are able to generate skills in terms of interpreting data, in terms of analyzing data and generating analytics out of this large amount of data coming from different sources through machine learning, through artificial intelligence, and other tools which are available in the hand of computer professionals, definitely you will be much, much ahead than other people in terms of entrepreneurship development. So the cloud-based system, today, people are not downloading data onto their systems. You know, this used to be the older domain. The data is residing on a big cloud, which is controlled by you know, big MNCs. But in India, we need to start developing our own infrastructure, because the security aspects is also very important. Cyber security is also very important. So generating cloud-based infrastructure in the country, and many of the young computer scientists, they should look up this as a big opportunity. We should have our own companies in this country, those who can provide cloud infrastructure for, you know, storing data, for providing data cloud services on loan basis. Cloud computing, big data analytics, in different fields of, you know, social aspects like agriculture sector is now becoming very, very important. Today, you know, India is still, you know, a country where more than 50% of our population directly or indirectly depends on the agriculture practices. And last year we have seen even many of the sectors which basically showed a negative growth in terms of GDP, but the agriculture sector was the only sector which basically still, you know, clog the positive growth in spite of all the challenges. And this year also is going to be more or less similar. So there is huge opportunities for the young techies in the broad field of agriculture, you know, the hydroponics agriculture or the agriculture crop insurance, or in the field of, you know, assessing the damages to the crop. That is a, you know, big niche area. Government of India is spending huge amount of money for agriculture insurance, but the information that which are the agriculture field or which are the fields where the crop damage has happened is not coming through. And crop insurance companies want that information very badly, that if a farmer is claiming for a settlement, you know, how to settle that you know, claim. So the satellite data or the data from drones becomes very important in terms of finding out the yield of the crops. Then energy is another area. And now we are moving from oil-based economy to the, you know, the renewable energy sources. The solar energy, so, you know, potential in India is huge, and that area is coming up like anything, and that will be the area where large amount of infrastructure development in this country will take place. So optimal, you know, availability of sunlight throughout the year, that's the biggest question. If I want to have a solar plant today, where I should put a solar plant so that I can get uninterrupted, you know, sunlight throughout the year? So using geospatial technology, you can find the solution. You can get the database on clouds, the cloud in the sky, not the computer cloud. And how many days in a year remains cloudy at a given location? That statistics is very important in setting up what will be the efficiency of this solar power plants. And even drone-based services are coming up in terms of providing service to the faulty solar panels, you know. If you have a few hectares long, you know, solar park, and few of your solar voltaic cell goes wrong, if they are faulty, how to identify them? So people are putting now thermal cameras on these drones, and then within few minutes you will come to know that which particular PV panel is having a problem, because it will be having higher temperature compared to the surrounding areas, and then the technician go and fix up. So large amount of entrepreneurship is coming in these areas where the UAV based solutions are coming up for various aspects. Cold chain management, this country need large amount of food processing capabilities or food storage capability. Large amount of food goes waste in this country, so we need to develop a cold chain especially in the northern part of the country to store perishable foods like potatoes, tomatoes, onions and other stuff. So if you are an entrepreneur who wants to develop this cold chain, you need to know from where, which are the sources, how far is the road infrastructure, how is the electricity scenario in that area. So all these databases, and how far are the mandis where you can take your produce and sell it off. So all this data, if you integrate on GIS platform, you can find solutions for identifying cold chain management, infrastructure. Weather and drought services, today there are a large amount of private entrepreneurs. IMD used to provide weather forecast, but today we have at least 3 to 4 private sector people, those who are now coming up SAT, SkyMet services and many other services which are now coming into the weather forecasting. And many of them are providing, the weather forecast services to the farmer directly at their mobile phone also, and developing very nice products through the help of, extensive marketing and sales strategies. Disaster risk management, you cannot avoid disasters, but the risk for disasters can be reduced by, scientific data collection and scientific interventions. So this is another area which is coming up very strongly, and with the help of insurance sector, the insurance companies in US, they put different kind of premiums for different, localities. If you are living very close to coastal area, and if you are vulnerable to the coastal hazards, or if you are living to the rivers, if you are vulnerable to the flood hazards, your premium for your insurance bill will be very different than a guy who is living in a much safer area. So in India, not much of work has been done on the risk assessment for various natural hazards, and large amount of private companies, especially in insurance sector, they need this information. So some of you can develop some of these entrepreneurship ideas in some of these areas in the field of disaster risk management. Recently we signed an MOU with our Indraprastha University in Delhi with their disaster management center, for developing newer program for the students for disaster risk management, as well as generating a kind of private startups in this broad field of disaster risk management, where large amount of investments are being done by private sector as well as by the government sector. Then the urban and the rural infrastructure. India still is a developing country, and a large amount of development is happening in the urban conglomerates. But the next few decades will be for the rural development. And many of you, and especially this pandemic has taught us that, I think it is good that many of us should spread out rather than concentrating in the urban areas. We have to, our population has to go out into the rural areas, and you will see in next few decades, one or two decades, there will be a reverse migration of people in India from urban conglomerates, big cities like Delhi, big cities like Mumbai, to the rural areas. A lot of people will do that migration, and if you get very good services, like city-like services in rural areas, with the kind of transportation service today we have, people will prefer to live in rural areas. So some of this rural infrastructure, and to create a rural economy, many of you can look up for entrepreneurship skills in times to come. Then lastly, I will like to say that, the education sector is also a big, entrepreneurship opportunity. And in last 2-3 decades, you have seen many private sector universities coming up. But the next era will be, with the kind of scenario is being developed, and we need multidisciplinary approach, will be on online learning and online, education resource generation. And that is going to be, this pandemic has taught us that how we should, move on from physical infrastructure or physical learning platforms to the online learning platform. So even though the pandemic may be over by this year or next year, but this online training and online learning will remain, now I feel, very much part and parcel of our lives. And mostly it may so happen that we will switch to hybrid mode of learning. So many of you can think of, you know, developing new entrepreneurship skills in this hybrid mode of learning and capacity building in terms of business development for various sectors, especially in the broad field of computer science and computational engineering, as well as for geospatial, you know, data management. So with these words, you know, I will not take much time. I thought that I would like to bring to your notice, especially in this part of the country, to the faculty members, as well as to the young students, those who are learning, what are the key opportunities, areas which will be available to develop your entrepreneurship skills in time to come, and which may remain sustainable for next one or two decades so that you can become a profitable business person. Thank you very much, Professor Dwivedi, as well as Tirthankar Mahavir University, for inviting me and sharing my views with each one of you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for such informational address. Now I would like to invite Dr. Garima Goswami to present the report of day one.
Sonia, okay, ma'am. Sonia, ma'am. Manjula, ma'am is there. Dr. Manjula.
Yeah, sorry. Now I would like to call Dr. Manjula Jain, Dean Academics. She is a very dynamic personality, and she's always there. Wherever we invite her, she loves to join us, and we really love, we are honored to have you as a part of our family. So over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Sonia, ma'am. Good afternoon to one and all, and thanks for that warm welcome. I'm also very much thankful to Professor Dwivedi, who has given me this opportunity to be the part of this 2 weeks FTP on entrepreneurship. And I also wish to thank our honorable patrons and Vice Chancellor, sir, and the other dignitaries, Professor K.K. Agarwal, sir, Professor Mittal, sir, Professor Prakash ji, who were very kind enough to share their words of wisdom on this very contemporary topic and very relevant for these days to come. So thank you once again, Professor Dwivedi, and the entire team. And since I've been given 5 to 10 minutes to speak, so I would quickly take up this time and would like to highlight few things on this very, very important topic, that is entrepreneurship. As we all know that our economy and future prosperity depends on many factors, but high among this list is the ability of the entrepreneurs and the innovators to develop their ideas into great enterprises. What I believe is, apart from the entrepreneurs, we should have to have the intrapreneurs also in the organizations, who can actually build upon the capacities of the organization and add value to their potentiality as well as to the outcomes. So when we talk about the leaders in the entrepreneurial field, they are none other than who used to tinker with their ideas when they used to be in the classrooms, and they used to enjoy what was not taught in the class, but what was tinkling in their minds. They went to college, they went to the universities, and they spent more of their time in the labs and on the last work benches rather than being the front benches. This just because they had the curiosity to solve the problems which they wanted to fix. You know that they have some things common in them. They love to solve the puzzles and the kind of challenges that most of us struggle with. So these are the people which we eventually think they take on the challenge of building and growing our economy. You know that the entrepreneurs exist everywhere in our economy. And we see that how our economy as well as the infrastructure has been transformed during the last years. We can see that there have been many avenues, whether there is in the financial sector, or that is in the energy sector, that is in the infrastructural sector, whether that is in the startup area, we can find that how scarcely we started. And now we are flourishing, we are thriving in those businesses. So in India also, we are very much proud for those entrepreneurs who began from rags and they became rich, making India also richer in their initiative to build upon its capacities. Whether we talk about Dhirubhai Ambani, whether we talk about Karsan Bhai Patel, who was man behind washing powder Nirma, every one of us has grown with this ad seeing in the televisions. And we can see that it has become a home household commodity. We can think of Kalpana Saroj. She is called to be the unbreakable woman and who is presently the CEO of Kamani Tubes. How can we forget Ramesh Babu? He is already known as the barber with the Rolls Royce. So there are a number of people whom you can think about who have been from rags to riches and they have changed the entire scenario of entrepreneurship in India and have made India to be proud of in the world scenario, if we say. So when we talk of what is actually entrepreneurship, so here we have to keep in mind that how we are contributing as universities, as colleges in this initiative. As we know that in Tirthankar Mahavir University also, we have been taking a lot of initiatives and in that we have IICs at the college level, which have been taking the initiatives being mandated by Ministry of Education and FOE as well as CCSIT has been the leaders into taking the entrepreneurial activities as well as various self-driven as well as the other activities which are given by the Ministry of Education in order to inculcate these entrepreneurial spirit amongst our budding managers as well as engineers. And I applaud all of you who are working to inspire, educate, and raise up this generation. We as the educational fraternity are making everything possible to make India a hotbed of innovation. And we are working tirelessly in that effort. And we are making all the efforts to make our students incumbent with those kind of skills which are required to be possessed by them. And I believe as what our eminent speakers just said, Professor K.K. Agarwal pointed out that inquisitiveness at school level is very, very important. And I believe that work begins first and foremost at home. And where parents must raise their children to encourage them to be curious and to expose them to, you know, important ideas in science, maths. Technical skills are also the building blocks of so much innovation, whether you are an engineering or a material science or a digital economy technologist. So I can tell you that influence of a parent is essential and getting a child to be interested in the act of discovery is one of the greatest gifts you can give to any young person. And it continues at the school level. So when our teachers must work every day to inspire our students, to challenge themselves and push beyond the core skills of any classroom. We at the university also can have the best innovators and entrepreneurs and those who had that skill at the school level in their minds, and we have to just nurture that skill at the college level. And we often find when we were also at the school level that repetition, memorization and rote learning were very uninteresting areas. And you know, it took years when we found that there are something more exciting and innovation starts here. So there are, you know, we should do various things and everything rather that we can do to identify these type of students early in life so that we can give them some outlet. And I feel again very proud to say that Faculty of Engineering and Computer Science also has raised such talents who had made us to feel proud at the national level by winning the hackathons also. And this is what we call that challenging the minds and reaping the entrepreneur out of them. So as an universities, as the educationist, we need to have this specialized education in terms of an ecosystem of innovation is created. And we should be known not by our education in the classes, but the kinds of discoveries and the innovations, inventions that can take place in our labs. And we also have to see that entrepreneurship can never be put up in chains, in some limited fixed curriculums. We have to give some kind of economic and curriculum freedom where the rule of law is not enforced. And if it is enforced, it is done very effectively, consistently, where the intellectual property is protected. So I'm very again proud to say that our faculty members are also coming up with a lot of patents these days, and they have been putting up a lot of their midnight oil being burned in order to come up with some kind of intellectual property. And that is really going to give us the impetus to bring up more and more entrepreneurs from our campus. So here we have a lot to offer. And finally, we all know that there is a lot to offer on this subject. And I would like to quote Thomas Edison, who was asked how he could remain optimistic after failing thousands of times. He said, "I haven't failed." He said, "I have discovered 10,000 ways that won't work." So this is what should be the attitude. Professor Raghuveer Singh, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, also said that once, who has not tasted failure cannot achieve the fruits of success. So it's not that you have to achieve the failure, but it's that if you pass through failure, it doesn't give you the discouragement, but gives you the encouragement and the experience to succeed with far more strength. So I would like to conclude that if we are really interested to building up a strong ecosystem of entrepreneurship and innovation, we have to expect it and welcome it. And innovation, invention does not, you know, occur with a very strong and powerful motive. We have to see that great ideas should come from great minds, and great minds, wherever they go, they have to be welcomed. And at Tirthankar Mahavir University, we welcome all great minds, and we wish entire team of my faculty members, our management, and various stakeholders to be the part and parcel in this important event to flourish, or to make this very important event happen in true sense. I assure you that driven by the technology revolution that we are facing, just as being the silver lining of the COVID-19, the future of next generations of entrepreneurs and innovators is yet to begin. Opportunities are there for those who have the motive, for those who have the inner thrust to invent, innovate, and work hard. At the Tirthankar Mahavir University, we have also been taking so many initiatives in order to prosper, in order to grow together, and give the fuel to the entrepreneurs by devising certain policies like seed money capital to all those who wish to come up with their ideas coming into a shape. And we are working hard towards that initiative. And with these words, I wish all the best for the success of this 2 weeks entrepreneurship faculty development program, and wish all the participants to learn and thrive with the deliberations in this event. Thank you so much, and wish you all the best.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Your words are always so inspiring and encouraging, and they always pump energy and enthusiasm in us and make us do better and better. It's always a pleasure to have you with us. Now, I would like to call Dr. Garima Goswami to present the report of day one. Ma'am, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Okay. An ignited mind is the most powerful resource to explore any single progressive possibility on the earth, above the earth, and under the earth. And this is got through education. Education is the most profitable investment for the near future. So a very good afternoon to everyone presenting over here, respected our chief guest, Professor K.K. Agarwal, sir, our guest of honor, Professor R.K. Mittal, sir, our guest of honor, Professor Prakash Chauhan, sir, our respected Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor Raghuveer Singh, our respected director, sir, Professor Rakesh Dwivedi, sir, respected Dean Academic, Professor Manjula Jain, ma'am, all faculty members and dear participants. On the behalf of Faculty of Engineering and Computer Sciences, Tirthankar Mahavir University, Moradabad, I, Dr. Garima Goswami, HOD Electrical Engineering Department, and convener of this DST-sponsored online FDP on entrepreneurship, express a great honor and privilege to speak before you to deliver a vote of thanks. First of all, I would like to extend my most sincere thanks to the Almighty God for making today's event a resounding success. With His blessing and grace, we are able to make this event what it was actually. I express my sincere thanks to the persons from DST also. Special thanks to Professor Naveen Vashishth, Director Scientist FNAB Division, for helping and supporting us through a lot of emails and telephonic communications for sanctioning the fund and for organizing these FDPs. Then I express sincere thanks to DST Observer, Mr. Pradeep Kumar Mishra, Vice Chancellor, Jharkhand University, for observing our all 44 upcoming sessions that are going to be starting from tomorrow onwards. I express my sincere thanks to our chief guest, Professor K.K. Agarwal, sir, Professor Akim Mittal, sir, Professor Prakash Chauhan, sir, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor Ragbir Singh, sir, and our Honorable Director, sir, and Honorable Associate Dean, ma'am, Professor Manjula Jain, for kindly accepting our invitation and for gracing this inaugural function and enlightening us with your valuable and precious words. Thank you so much, sir and ma'am, for gracing the event. Then I'm highly thankful to our management team. I express my sincere thanks to our Honorable Chancellor, sir, Shushirish Jainji, Group Vice Chancellor Shri Manish Jainji, and I express my sincere thanks to esteemed member of TME Society, Shri Akshar Jainji, for giving us all-time support and all-time favor to organize this event. I'm highly thankful to our all management team, Dr. Manjula Jain, ma'am, Associate Dean, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, our Registrar, sir, Dr. Aditya Sharma ji, for giving us all-time support and valuable time and positive responses all time. Thank you, sir, ma'am. I'm thankful to our Professor Rakesh Dwivedi, sir, Director, FOECS, for his inspiring mentorship and motivational support to organize this event. Thank you so much, sir. I acknowledge the unwavering support received from the co-convener of this FDP, Dr. Pankaj Kumar Goswami and Dr. Gulista Khan. I express my sincere thanks to both of them. Thank you so much. My thanks also go to all the committee members who have given their precious time in organizing this event. The special thanks goes to Ms. Shikha Gambhir, ma'am, Mr. Jyoti Ranjan Lab, Mr. Umesh Kumar Singh, Mr. Ajay Chakravarti, sir, Dr. Sandeep Kumar Verma, sir, Dr. Sonia Jayant, ma'am, and Dr. Ajay Chakravarti, sir, Dr. Sandeep Verma, Dr. Tripathi, sir, Aarti Tripathi, sir, for all the pre-position tasks of related event. I take this opportunity to thank all the session coordinators who are going to coordinate all the 44 upcoming sessions starting from tomorrow till 8th of May. I express my thanks to print media, electronic media, for the wider coverage of this FDP. Thank you so much, each and everyone. At the last but not the least, I express my sincere thanks to all the participants from various institutions and universities, and I express my best wishes to all participants. I'm sure that the participant will definitely be benefited by attending this FDP. Thank you so much, each and everyone. Now, I express my sincere thanks to each and everyone who are associated with this FDP directly and indirectly to make this inaugural function as a successful event. Now, I request everyone to make their camera please on so that we can capture a group photograph to have a beautiful memory of this event, please. Thank you so much, each and everyone. I express my heartly thanks to all the HODs also, Dr. Ravi Jain sir, and Dr. Zareen Farooq ma'am, who gave all-time support to us for organizing this event. Thank you so much, sir and ma'am. There is an announcement to all the participants. There is an FDP feedback link in the chat box. After this event, you need to just fill that feedback form and submit it immediately after this event. And all the information regarding to the upcoming sessions will be given to you on the WhatsApp group that has been made for the participants also. You'll get all the information over there regarding sessions. Dr. Prakash Chauhan sir, may we have you over here? Thank you so much, each and everyone. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for gracing the event. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you, Dr. Gariba.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm highly thankful to all of you for making this event a great success. And participants, we will meet in the group and for the next, for upcoming sessions. Thank you so much. Thank you, each and everyone.
Thank you, ma'am.
Be safe. Be stay at home. Be safe. Please take care of yourself.
Good morning, madam. Hello.
Yes, sir, please.
Madam, I'm opening the feedback form, yes. It is given that you have to take permission.
Sure. Okay, sure. I'm giving permission from here. You just try within 2 minutes. Okay.
Share this on the WhatsApp group.
Sure. I will send in the WhatsApp group also, the same link.
Okay.
Actually, ma'am, it asked only owner permission. So, yeah, the same message I also received, ma'am.
Okay. No problem. I will send this feedback link in the group also.
Okay. Thank you.
You will be able to fill over there. Thank you so much, each and every.